close the eyes and pull like a dog.
And a new Irish record for Phil Healy, 22.99.
Christy Cooney hands over the Sam Maguire Cup to Graham Canty, Cork All-Ireland champions for the seventh time ever.
Hello and welcome to the Star Sport Podcast. My name is Jack McCarran of the Southern Star, and I'm joined as always by Star Sport editor Kieran McCarthy. Before we kick things off, I'd just like to give a gentle reminder to our listeners and viewers to please rate, review and subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify and YouTube. We're edging ever closer to 1,000 subscribers on YouTube as well. So if you could get on there and click subscribe, that would be a great help for me and Kieran. We're heading to France this week to catch up with La Rochelle's new recruit, Dunmanway's Darren Sweetnam. The former Munster and Ireland winger has recently switched from the Pro 14 to join Ronan O'Gara's Top 14 Revolution. And we caught up with him just hours before he made his debut for his new club, La Rochelle, on Friday. We'll also hear from Cork and Courcey Rovers Camogie star Lina Collins, who spoke to Ger McCarthy about the imminent return of inter-county action, as well as Courcey's historic senior county championship win in 2020. But first, Kieran, the news broke on Sunday that 12 clubs from across Europe are set to launch a brand new European Super League competition. A statement from the Super League confirmed that AC Milan, Arsenal, Atletico Madrid, Chelsea, Barcelona, Inter Milan, Juventus, Liverpool, Manchester City, Manchester United, Real Madrid and Tottenham Hotspur have all joined as founding clubs. The statement did not clarify when the inaugural season will be, but it did mention that it would commence as soon as possible. The competition format puts it directly head-to-head with UEFA's own Champions League. So, Kieran, a lot to take in, but what are and were your initial thoughts when the news came across your timeline over the weekend?
I think over the years, we've all heard talks about possible Super Leagues and so on, but never really thought it would actually come to fruition in the way that it has. And it seems to be a deal that's a long way down the line, even by the clubs you mentioned there. Like, they've all released their different statements late on Sunday night and their various club websites, and they seem hell-bent on going ahead with this. It's just, it's hard at this early stage to still wrap your head around it, Jack, because we don't know what the long-term effect or what the big effect will be on the rest of football. But straight away, I'm not a fan of it, because I've grown up, I suppose, on the Premier League. Kind of some of my early memories are even going back to when United and West Ham drew nil-all in the, I think it was 94, 95, or maybe around in the last day of the season, and Blackburn beat Liverpool. I was in a pub with my dad watching that game because we didn't even have Sky Sports. You know, kind of grown up on a diet of Premier League football. And I think that this Super League, it'll sound a death knell in a way for the Premier League, because for all these big six, as they call them, their eyes will be on this European Super League. And that will devalue the Premier League, because no longer will they need to finish in the top four to qualify for this European competition, because the big six and these founding members, they're guaranteed their position in this league every year, which is nuts in a way, because that means there's no competition there. If United finish bottom of the Super League, whatever, if it does get off the ground, they're still in it next year. There's no relegation there for these founding members. So I don't know. I'm not a big fan, and I'm not a fan too of the name. How can you call a league that includes Spurs and Arsenal a Super League? There's no Dortmund, there's no Bayern, there's no Benfica, there's no PSG, there's no Ajax. We're talking about the big names of European soccer. Instead, we've six clubs from England, three from Italy, three from Spain. Looks like it's going to progress, Jack, but as a fan right now, I'm not in favour.
Well, you mentioned the name and how the Super League, how is it a Super League when it doesn't actually have all of the best teams? But it's basically boils down to the fact that this is an Americanization of European soccer, in the same way that the NFL called the Super Bowl the World Champions, when it's the only 16 or 32 American teams who actually compete in the sport. So how on earth could it be called the World Championship? They say the same in the World Series of Baseball, etc. And the fact that a lot of the clubs involved in this as founding members, so Liverpool, for example, Manchester United, who has Arsenal. They are all owned or run in some degree by American owners who are also involved in American football teams in America. So Stan Kroenke at Arsenal, the John Henry at Liverpool is involved with the Boston Red Sox, and so on and so forth. And the Glazers, of course, at Man United, Joe Glazer was quoted in all of his statements. So I very much see this as them trying to turn European soccer into more. Well, it is. I'm not Joe breaking new ground by saying this. It's basically their attempt to recreate the NFL with European soccer. And as anyone who listens to this or who follows NFL in any way, shape or form, NFL is the only show in town when it comes to American football, as in there is not like lower league NFL matches that are also across the weekend. It's basically just the 32 big teams that are involved, and that's it. And this is essentially what the European Super League is going to do. It's going to cut off all links with, say, using the English example, the Championship or League One or League Two, and even using the Irish context, like when a Dundalk or a Cork City qualify for the Champions League or the Europa League group stages, their biggest prize is the potential to play one of these clubs. Like we saw with Shamrock Rovers when they drew Tottenham in the Europa League a number of years back. That's going to be stripped away potentially because the Irish clubs will still be competing in whatever's left of the Europa League and the Champions League qualifying rounds. But the big names will no longer be there. So that idea that you could dream from 5, 6 or 7, and I know I've seen this written around the place everywhere, like Ana Herrera, a player I'm sure you're fond of and have fond memories of from his time with Man United, he made the point on social media that that idea that your club could potentially rise up and take on the best the game in Europe has to offer by qualifying for the Champions League knockout rounds and then the group stages, that's essentially going to be taken away because all the big boys, in theory, will focus their attention on the European Super League, of which they're all going to be guaranteed spots every year. No relegation, no promotion, similar to the NFL. And like any time in Europe, we copy something that the Americans do, it's never good. Like, I don't know why we always look to them for inspiration. US soccer guy on Twitter, I don't know if you remember him. He used to be quite funny back in the day. He hasn't been as prominent recently, but I seen he did have a tweet that kind of summed it up for me. And he just basically said, real awesome to see MLS Europe move one humongous step closer to being a reality. And like, it's obviously satirical, but he makes a valid point. And so, yeah, I'm with you, Kieran. I'm not a fan of this in the slightest, but I do think it's going to happen because money talks, unfortunately, in this society, especially when it comes to big high-level sport.
100%. You said money talks, Jack. The money they're talking around here is astronomical. It's billions and billions and billions of euros. Even the clubs for competing, I think even, is it every year, they might get between 200 and 250 million euros to compete in this Super League compared to the money that they generate off the Champions League. So it comes down to greed. It comes down to money. You mentioned there the American owners of so many of these clubs. They've seen the model that over in America with the NFL, and they're trying to introduce the exact same thing here with this European Super League. And just looking again at, if you've Spurs and Arsenal in a Super League derby kind of late in the season, when the two teams are after getting hockeyed by every other side in it, where's the interest in that? Because they can't get relegated. They can't win the competition. It's midweek. It's almost a dead rubber of a game. So even though they're billing it as a Super League, some games will be super, but there'll be a lot of dead rubbers in it too. And I'm, even as a Man United fan, United haven't won the Champions League since 2008, haven't won the league since 2013. United haven't qualified for how many Champions League campaigns over the last couple of years. Yet suddenly, because of the history and tradition of the club, and because they're known as one of the big clubs in the world, they just take their spot here automatically. But results on the pitch over the last couple of years, they haven't even deserved to get to the Champions League, and they've missed out on qualification. So that's why it just doesn't sit easy with me, that this lack of competition in this new league, which is all about money. That's all it comes down to. These big clubs will get richer, and that means the gap between them and the other clubs will get bigger and bigger and bigger. And stories like Leicester winning the Premier League a couple of years ago, like, that's, I know it's one of those, doesn't happen too often, but that was a great story. Leicester kind of shocked the big boys, got their hands on the league title, got into the Champions League the following season. It's the romanticism of football. It shows that it can happen. But those stories are will dead in the water now, because a Leicester winning the Premier League, they can't get into this Super League. You know, kind of, I know they're talking about there could be 20 clubs in the Super League at some stage, and 15 of them are the founder members, and there's a way that five other teams might be able to get in and out. But it just doesn't sit right at all, Jack. And the sad thing is, it looks like it's going to progress. It's so advanced, it seems, at this stage that I don't know how UEFA, I know they've been pretty hard hitting with their rhetoric today. I don't know how they're going to stop this, because it's a runaway train at the moment. And when you see Joel Glazer's name appearing on Liverpool website and the Man City website, you know there's something stinks right here.
That's the thing. It's like almost puke inducing, some of the things that are associated with it. And I saw one tweet that particularly made me want to hurl all over myself, to use an American phrase, hurl, just to keep on the theme of today's discussion. But it was that in the discussions amongst the founding members, when they're plotting, we'll say, a phrase they're using to describe the fans of their clubs based in their cities are legacy fans. Joe, these are old news. They'll always be there, so we don't need to worry about them too much. They're now focusing on their new fan bases, you know, in this globalized economy. So the Liverpool fans who have been, or United fans, or Juventus fans, or whoever, who've been going home and away for 30 or 40 years, you know, spending all their money, they're now seen as legacy fans. They're not quite as important. They don't really matter. We're going to focus on the Chinese and Indonesian markets, which, look, I understand that is capitalism. That is how the world's economy works, but that doesn't make it okay in my book. And just to finish, before you can maybe give your final thoughts in it, I think one of the beautiful things about soccer, and one of the reasons it's been so successful globally for over 100 years, the reason it's the biggest sport in the world, is because through a series of leagues and competitions, it's all interconnected totally. So even if you're playing, as I did, in like the 50th tier of London Sunday League, you could still, in theory, climb the ladder and qualify into the Football League, or enter the FA Cup and go on a dream run. And that, even though you know in your heart of hearts that's never going to happen, but it's just that idea that you're playing in the same competition as the stars of the Premier League, or even in Ireland in Sunday League junior soccer, in theory the Baltimore Crabs could enter the FAI Cup and win a few rounds and go on and play Cork City. And again, that is never likely to happen. But the idea that you're all playing under the one umbrella is what makes it such a special game. And I think this is going to cut that link completely. This European Elite Super League is, in theory, going to be a separate entity from the rest of the global game, because although FIFA and UEFA haven't covered themselves in glory the last ever, you know, at least they are representative of the entire game globally. Like, there are FIFA delegates from Botswana, there are UEFA delegates from San Marino and Malta. You know, it's not totally all about the top tier team. So I think that's one of the saddest things. It's going to turn a globalized game into a elitist 12 team competition. And it's just it's a bit annoying, like, you know, that they can just do this. But I don't know if you want to make a final point before we move on and talk about something more positive.
Yeah, just, you mentioned there about legacy fans, Jack, and that comes back to what I was saying at the start about when I was young, going off to my dad take me to the pub to watch that United West Ham game where United lost the league at Upton Park. But fans nowadays, there's a new generation of fans that I'm not really tapped into, but I was reading something very interesting online that they're growing up in this kind of these FIFA competitions and this fantasy football world where you can have Mbappe, Messi and Ronaldo in the same forward line, and it's almost this aspirational fantasy football as such. And I think what this European Super League is looking to tap into these sort of fans and get them on board as new fans and almost a new stream of revenue. And they're leaving the real fans, you could say, behind them. And while I know a lot of fans, you could see the outrage on social media since this news broke, and a lot of, well, most fans, nearly all fans, are disgusted with what's happening. will you stop watching Liverpool if they're in the Super League? Like, I'm not going to, like, I won't stop watching Man United. I'm not going to burn my United jerseys or burn my scarf. I'm still going to watch United. And I think the clubs know that too, that there will be this outrage, there will be this backlash, but that will die down and this thing will press on. So
I'm uneasy about it. I hope it doesn't come to pass. But capitalism has a way of just plowing through and soaking up all the money that's available and spewing out all the little people. And capitalism hasn't been stopped yet, and I don't think it's going to be stopped anytime soon. But let's talk about something more positive now, Kim, because we could go on about that all day and come up with no solution, because the anger is palpable across Europe. But one player who has made the switch to the continent is Dunmanway's Darren Sweetnam. Nice little segue there. Who's left Thomond Park and Munster to join Ronan O'Gara's French Revolution at La Rochelle. And Kieran, you spoke to Darren just before he made his debut for his new club on Friday evening. So maybe first of all, tell us how his debut went, because this podcast was, of course, recorded before that game. And then maybe talk to us about Darren's switch.
So Darren came on as a 60-minute sub for La Rochelle as they beat Lyon 38-23 at home in the top 14 on Saturday night. So that was Darren Sweetnam's first taste of top 14 rugby, and hopefully the first of many appearances to come. So I caught up with Darren just before that, just to check in with him to see how he's settling in France since he swapped Thomond Park for the southeast of France. So the good news is he's settling in well, as you'll hear from now quite soon. He's got set up with an apartment and a car from La Rochelle. He's looking forward for now to the end of the season, because he's there on a short-term contract, Jack. And the hope for Darren is that he can impress La Rochelle enough that they might offer him a contract for next season, or some other club might come in and offer him a contract, because Darren Sweetnam was out of contract with Munster this summer and a new contract was not forthcoming. So he had to take his future into his own hands and take control of his destiny. And that's why he's decided to join La Rochelle until the end of the season. And Ronan O'Gara was a huge part of that decision. It was a phone call from Ronan O'Gara that kicked off this chain of events that saw Darren make his debut for La Rochelle last Saturday night. So like I said, big couple of weeks and months ahead for Darren Sweetnam. He's trying to secure his future, but as you'll hear from him now, he's in good form. Now we're going all the way to the southwest of France to catch up with a Dunmanway man who was putting his Leaving Cert French to good use. Welcome to the podcast, Darren.
Thanks very much for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here.
So before we chat rugby, La Rochelle and Munster, you made the move to La Rochelle 2 weeks ago. So just to see, how are you settling in so far? And have you a chance to see much of the city, Darren?
Not really, not at the moment, to be honest, because of COVID, everything's kind of closed down. So it's only takeaway kind of food and stuff at the moment. But I've had a walk around the city, and it's an incredible place. It's absolutely beautiful. And obviously the weather's been great as well since I got over. I'm settling in good now. I kind of have my apartment and my and the club gave me a car as well. So it's great. I'm settling in well now at the moment, and I'm really enjoying it actually.
You'll be able to get out and about in the car. So just to check on that Leaving Cert French, are you putting it all to good use?
Oh, geez, I don't know, Kieran. That was 9 years ago now. I think it's all here in the back of my head. I just need to bring it out somehow. But I'm getting the hang of it. So the club have a French teacher. So I'm doing lessons once a week with him. So to be fair, I can do all the greetings and the bonjours and the savant and whatnot. But after that, there's not much in there at the moment. But I'll get there.
I can actually sense a new section in the Star Sports section of the next couple of weeks. Learn French with Darren Sweetnam. It could be something that we could run every week. Darren Sweetnam teaches us a new French phrase every week.
No, I don't think so.
So before we look back at your Munster career, let's chat about this move to La Rochelle, because it seemed to come about very fast. You packed up your locker on a Friday at Munster and you were over in France a couple of days later. So how fast did this move come about, and when did you first hear that it was a possibility?
Oh no, it happened very, very fast. Ronan O'Gara rang me, I think it was a Monday night, and he wanted me over before the next Monday, because I think just to be registered for Europe. But things were stalled kind of on this side. So I didn't get over it until the following weekend. But yeah, it all happened very quick, to be honest, because he called me and I was ready to go, and then things were stalled a little bit, but eventually kind of got done anyway, and I'm here now. So but it was kind of a bit of a whirlwind, really, because on one side I was obviously sad to leave Munster, I didn't want to leave, but on the other side, it's a massive opportunity, and to work with Rog as well, like I couldn't really turn it down, you know.
And how much was that opportunity to work under Ronan O'Gara a part of your decision to go there? Because he said, since you're the first Munster player he's ever signed as a coach, so you'll always have a piece, a place in Ronan O'Gara's heart for that. But the chance to work with him, how important was that?
Oh, geez, absolutely. It was massive. You know, him being a Munster hero, a hero of mine growing up, obviously. I say he would have been one of the main reasons I actually kind of got into rugby. So to actually be able to work with him and, you know, just to kind of learn from him, really, is obviously an opportunity I couldn't really refuse. And he's, like, since I've got over, he's just been so welcoming. You know, he's had me over to his house and everything, just to meet his family, who are absolutely lovely and everything. So, yeah, it was a tough decision, because obviously I've been in Munster since 2012, and you know, I never really saw it ending this early. But I guess, look, I didn't have anything at the end of the season anyway. So when Raj rang me, I was like, yeah, absolutely, I'd love to work with you, and hopefully I can add something to the team, because they're going very well at the moment as well. So yeah, it was just a great opportunity.
Like, obviously, mentioned there, Ronan O'Gara, he's done great things with La Rochelle, kind of Europe, flying high in the top 14. He's really putting together a very strong coaching CV himself. But besides that, the fact it's a familiar face, a familiar voice for you, a fellow Corkman, it must help you even settle in over that little bit more.
Yeah, 100%. Just from from a Corkman as well, you know. He's so welcoming, and it definitely helps that, like, I know someone over here as well. You know, I'm not going over here and don't know a person. But even the lads as well, like, there's a lot of English speaking lads on the team as well, who are very friendly and very welcoming as well. So to be fair, it's been an easier transition than I thought it would be. But the only thing is just getting the hang of the French. The language barrier is probably the hardest thing, but because all the coaching and all the chat on the pitch and everything is in French, obviously. So I just need to get my head around that a little bit, but I'll get there eventually.
So when you went over, Darren, it's a 3-month deal as injury cover until the end of the season. So what's the thought process behind this move for you? Is it put yourself in the shop window, get game time for La Rochelle, and then either they might offer you a contract or some other club might come in and offer you a contract for next season? Is that basically what you're hoping to get out of this?
Yeah, exactly. It was just premium contract. So, but it was it's a great opportunity to kind of get my, I don't know, I suppose, get into France as well. You know, it's get the foot in the door. And hopefully if I go well, there might be something here, or else some other club might pick me up as well. So it's risky, but then again, it's not either, because I didn't have anything back home. So, hopefully I can stay on here, because it's an incredible club. But if not, hopefully someone else will pick me up as well.
With Laura Guest on the podcast a couple of weeks ago, and she was telling us that she thinks your game is suited for French rugby. Did you always keep an eye on the top 14, and what do you like about it?
Oh yeah, I definitely did. It's the only problem is in Ireland, it's very hard to watch it, because it's Clan Plus, isn't it? But you know, you'd always there'd always be videos on YouTube and Instagram and stuff. And but yeah, like the top 14 is just they focus more on keeping the ball alive. I think there's a lot of Islanders over as well that are grew up practicing offloading and offloading after contact and stuff. So I think that kind of suits my game as well. So I'm really excited now to get kind of stuck into things and just play heads up rugby and more unstructured, and hopefully that will suit me more.
You mentioned there about training, and I presume like it's obviously very high quality training, but what was that first training session like for you?
It was good. It was refreshing because it's very different to Munster's. Obviously, first of all, the coaching's done in French, so I kind of have to ask the lads, oh, what's he saying there? But rugby's kind of the same all over the world, really. It's just getting the hang of it. It was good. It's intense, and I'm getting better day by day, to be honest. I'm flying it.
Like there's hopefully, fingers crossed, big things ahead in the colours of La Rochelle. So let's look back in your time in the red of Munster. How tough a decision was it so to say goodbye to Munster? Like you said earlier, you were there since 2012. You've had almost 100 appearances for Munster. You were the young player of the year back in 2017. You achieved so much. So for you to decide, the next part of my career lies away from this club, was that a very tough decision for you to make?
Yeah, it was. It was and it wasn't. It was tough because, as I said, it's my home club. It's the club that, you know, I dreamed of playing for growing up, and I haven't achieved. I didn't achieve really what I kind of set out to achieve. But I would like to have made those 100 caps. But I also have to look back at it and be like, look, I've had a great career, and I've had the opportunity to play in some massive games and play with some incredible players. I look back with very fond memories. Like, I've had some incredible days, even the Maori All Black game, the Glasgow game, and the Axel game. There's a lot of games that stand out, but yeah, it's incredible, but it's sad as well in a way that I kind of has to end like this, because I didn't even get to say a proper goodbye to the lads or anything like that. Could just happen so fast, but I've made Munster's full of incredible people as well, and I've made some friends for life. So I look back with really fond memories, but I'm really looking forward to this opportunity and what's ahead now. So yeah,
because you wrote a contract in the summer with Munster, Darren. When did you get the inkling that there wasn't going to be an offer there that for you for next season and the season after?
It's hard to kind of say a specific date, but I was kind of getting the vibes anyway that, look, things weren't looking great. I was falling down the pecking order. Look, it's tough to know. You just kind of get the vibes when you're not playing and there's lads playing ahead of you that, you know. I don't know how to answer that one really.
Like you said, now you have that opportunity with La Rochelle, but even to reflect there on some of those highlights, like you mentioned there at Munster, that Axel game, your first Champions Cup try against Toulouse, I think, the scoring the try against the Maori All Blacks in 2016. Yeah. Like, you could fill a highlights reel with those alone. So if you were to pick the top one or two, which are the ones that stand out for you, Darren?
I say probably the Maori All Black try, just because the atmosphere was absolutely incredible. And then obviously the Toulouse game as well. I scored a try in that game. It's just the atmosphere in Tolman Park. And then what else? When I made a tackle, remember, to race back against Glasgow. And just the roar that day was, obviously all the emotions involved in that day as well was incredible. So, there's been so many great days there. It makes me kind of emotional thinking about it now that I'm never going to play in a packed Tolman Park again. But look, that's sport that can be cruel sometimes. But you move on pretty quickly, and it's kind of on to the next thing now, really.
And what is it like to play in a packed Tolman Park? You just mentioned the roar of the crowd there.
Yeah. As I said before, it's they almost make you play above yourselves, really. just you can actually give that extra bit when like you have that crowd behind you. I know it's kind of a cliche, but it is actually like having a 16th man. But over here as well, supposedly it's a massive rugby city and the fans here are supposed to be incredible. So hopefully I get to experience that when things open up again, which who knows when that will be. But I was looking at some videos on YouTube and I think it was when they got promoted up to the top 14. And I think the players got a boat like into the port and it literally just swarmed with people around the port and it's absolutely incredible. So I'd love to experience that, but who knows? Who knows if I will be able to, but yeah. So
oh, that sounds class. And I was going to say too, Darren, your part in this entire West Cork rugby story is so important because I've said before, you're a fellow who joined the dots from West Cork to Thomen Park, and you showed fellas in West Cork that it is possible to play rugby professionally. When you look back now to when you made that decision in 2012 to go down the rugby path, did you ever think that you'd achieve what you did, like play with Munster, three caps at Ireland, now you're going to be playing in the top 14 with La Rochelle in France? Do you ever think that decision would lead to such highs?
Honestly, no, I didn't. I suppose back then you don't look too far ahead either. Obviously, you dream about all those things, like you want to play in Thomond Park and Highland Cup, and you want to play for Ireland and stuff. But at the time, you're kind of just taking it one step at a time, really. But now that I look back on it, and yeah, I'm really proud of what I achieved. And hopefully, it's not over yet, obviously. Hopefully, I can kind of push on over here now as well and kind of start a new journey.
Because as well, when the news came out that you were going to La Rochelle, what stood out to me is you're only 27, 28, because you've been around for so long. For some reason, I thought you were a lot older than you are. So like, you still have a lot of rugby left to play. And Laura Guest made that point on the podcast too a couple of weeks ago. Keith Earls is 33 now, and he's in the form of his life. And you're, 27, 28. So you've a big chunk of your career left to play. So you must be hungry and ready now just to get out and play again.
Yeah, well, I think Keith Earls is kind of out on his own, really. He seems to be getting better with age, but no, exactly. I'm still young. I still have hopefully good few more years in fresh and rugby. So just need to kind of keep working hard and yeah, just see what happens really.
Talk about working hard. The lads in West Cork have been working hard over the last couple of years. I know there's a huge West Cork influence. Oh. In Munster at the moment, it's incredible. Gavin Coombs is having the season of his life. Fionnuala Richley was in with Ireland last year. John Hodnett's obviously highly rated. You've Liam Coombs, Jack Crowley, Josh Witcher.
Oh, it's incredible.
What's it been like the last couple of years to see all these West Cork lads come up into Munster and make their presence felt as well?
Oh, it actually makes me so happy to see so many of just your own West Cork lads in and around the squad. And it's crazy because it just happened so fast over like the last couple of years. You just see like Gav has taken it to the next level. He's going to be in Irish jersey before we know it. And Fineen, and as you said, like John Hodden as well. Obviously, he's been unlucky with that injury, but before that, he was absolutely flying it, and I'm sure he'll get back to that those levels again. But like Liam Coombs, there's incredible talent. It's just I think now that it's actually, because there's always talent being in West Cork. It's just the fact that we need to find the talent. But now that I think they know, they're obviously going to look more. And I think as well, now the players coming up underage will see that, look, there's a lot of West Cork lads in this Munster squad. We can do it as well. So I reckon you'll see a lot more West Cork lads coming up through the ranks. And yeah, it's great. It's absolutely great to see. I can't wait to see, you know, like what Gav does and John and Fineen as well, like both Witchley brothers. I didn't even mention them, sorry, but they're obviously absolutely incredible as well. So yeah, it's so exciting for West Cork, and West Cork is incredible. Like, there's some amazing sports people as well. So yeah, I'm a very proud West Cork man. So
Oh, that's great to hear. And you mentioned obviously Gavin Coombs there, like I said, form of his life. And you said there, it's probably not too long before he gets an Irish senior cap. Like, you have three caps to your name, but do you think someone like Gavin potentially has a big career ahead of him internationally?
Oh, absolutely. I absolutely think so, yeah. And especially now with CJ Stander retiring, that'll hopefully give him a few more opportunities at eight. So, I think he's going to push on, and who knows? Like, the sky's the limit for him. He can rack up as many caps as he wants, really, I think. So, it's very exciting for him, and he's class act.
You mentioned there about being very proud to be from West Cork, and Donny's GA is very proud that you played for them before, and I threw out a tweet there after you signed for La Rochelle, and I said that the Donny's hurlers will have to hold off a couple of years until they get Darren Sweetnam back in their club colours. I'm thinking of Tomás O'Leary here years ago when he came back to play with Aaron's Own. Is it something ever in the back of your mind, like way, way, way down the line, like when the professional rugby career finishes up in your mid to late 30s, that you'd ever think, all right, I'll go back to the Donnies for one more year and show them what I'm all about?
I don't know, Kieran. I don't know if the body would be up to it, but no, if the body's up to it, I'd definitely be up for a few games. I don't know, would it be probably Junior B or something like that, but I still have the odd puck around there. So, yeah, I'd love to, but who knows? My girlfriend's Scottish, so... I don't know, will I be coming back to Ireland or will I come to Scotland? But there's no hurling over there. It might be shinty. Who knows?
So what's the plan for the next couple of weeks, so Darren? Kind of, is the hope to get a couple of top 14 appearances and, like I said earlier, show them what you can do?
Yeah, exactly. Just kind of put my best foot forward now. Hopefully get a few games and play well and just kind of show Raj really what I can do and kind of go from there, really.
When you have a motivation like that, like, you've a point to prove in a way and you've this short window to prove it. So are you very motivated right now to show Ronan O'Gara and La Rochelle just how good Darren Sweetnam is?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, 100%. I kind of feel like I have a point to prove as well and show that I'm still capable of playing at this top level. So... I think it shows faith as well that Raj brought me over, and it gives me a bit of confidence that he brought me over when La Rochelle are going so well, and I'm coming over at a very important part of the season. So that gives me a lot of confidence, and hopefully I can kind of portray that on pitch now and push on and show people what I'm still capable of.
Can you tell us what Ronan O'Gara said to you when he touched base with you first and when you came over? Like, what is he hoping to get out of you for the next couple of weeks and months?
He just said, basically have a go, really, and just don't worry about the detail or anything like that. Just back yourself, and it's a great opportunity for you like to play very attractive rugby. So hopefully I'll see a lot of the ball, a lot more ball, and a lot more ball in space as well, which is really exciting, and I can't wait to get on the pitch with them now. Because you even get glimpses of that in training. It's just they play with a lot more wit than what we might have seen in Munster. So it's really exciting and really looking forward to it.
And playing with that more wit, that's right up your alley. So like, you can stretch the legs and show what you can do.
Exactly. Hopefully get the ball with a bit more time and a bit more space and kind of get an opportunity to take on guys one-on-one. And that's what every winger wants. So, hopefully get those opportunities now.
It's exciting times ahead in the next couple of weeks and months. Yeah. We might do, Darren, in a couple of weeks, we might check back in to see how those French lessons are going, and we might have this podcast in French in 3 months' time.
You'll have to practice your French as well, so, and we'll have a conversation in the French.
That sounds like a challenge. We'll have to take that one up. But come here, Darren, thank you so much for giving us your time today, and best of luck in the weeks and months ahead.
Oh, thanks very much, Kieran. Thanks a million for having me as well. It's been great.
Thanks for listening to the Star Sport Podcast, #1 for sport in West Cork.
2020 was a marquee year for our next guest, primarily because she was part of the Courcey Rovers side that famously landed the club's first senior county Camogie title. And Ger McCarthy caught up with Lina Collins to chat about that and the imminent return of the inter-county Camogie scene.
Delighted to be joined by the new Cork senior Camogie captain, Lina Collins from the Courcey Rovers Club. Lina, thank you very much for joining us here on the Southern Star Sports Podcast.
No problem, Jerry. Thanks for having me.
First of all, congratulations. Captain of your county is a lovely accolade. When did it happen? And when did you get news of this? And how did it happen?
Yeah, so I suppose being captain of Cork is something I never would have thought I would end up being, but it's a great achievement. I'm really, really looking forward to the year ahead. Just thinking of all the people that have gone before me as captain of Cork and all the people I've played under, it is a great achievement and I am really looking forward to the year. A few months ago, I suppose my club put me forward as we had won the county this year. So if the club chooses then from the who's going to be captain, and they decided it would be me. So I suppose it's an honour then for me to be able to represent my club and represent my family on the Cork scene as well. And even for the group of girls, I suppose we've been playing together so often now and in the last few years that it's great for me to be able to represent the girls as well and bring everyone together again after such a tough time of it last year. So hopefully now it'll be a positive year.
I would imagine you, like all your teammates and your club mates, are just delighted now that the opportunity to get back out on the pitch and training is around the corner.
Yes, definitely. As I was saying to you earlier, I'm teaching fifth class at the moment and I was training them hurling today. And all I wanted to do was join in and put on a helmet because they were just having so much fun and getting stuck in. And that was all I wanted to do was really join them. But it's very exciting. And I mean, we've gone so long without it. Now everyone is so eager and enthusiastic to get back. So no, definitely looking forward to it. And I know the girls are as well, and we're all counting down the days.
How difficult has it been for Summer Cove National School and just teaching and throughout the pandemic for you?
It's been different. I suppose, you know, the children are really adaptable and they're adapting really well to it. But it is definitely different, you know, reminding them to sanitize, reminding them to stay in their pods in their class and things like that. And I suppose the mask as well, you'd nearly be dizzy at the end of the day with wearing the mask all day and they can't hear you and you can't hear them. And it's all a bit frustrating. But, you know, I mean, it's a lot better than being stuck at home because, to be honest, that wasn't much better. So I'd much rather be in school and have the buzz of going to school and seeing the kids and stuff. So, no, it's the best of what it could be, really, I suppose.
Good stuff. Now, a National League campaign. Brilliant. We get to talk about matches that are coming up and something for Cork to aim for. But before we just talk about the two teams you'll be playing, talk to me about your manager, Paddy Murray, and how important he has been in your career, but also to the current Cork setup.
Yeah, Paddy has put in so many years, so many hours, so much time into Cork Camogie that credit where credit is due, because he always wants to get the best out of the team. He always wants to bring in the best management. He's always talking about how we can get better, how we can improve, and it's constantly improving. He's never happy with just staying the same. He always wants to improve. So I suppose that's why Cork Camogie has done so well in the past few years. So I suppose this year now we really want to lay down a marker. And as I said, we've new management in there this year. We've Kevin Murray back. We've a new S&C in Kevin Dunn. Matthew Toomey and Teddy O'Donovan are back as well. So there's a good crew coming back together. So next Tuesday, really, it's getting to see everyone back together and then build from there. But Paddy has put together such a good management team that we'd like to do that justice now by representing ourselves well on the pitch.
Now, there was a curtailed league campaign last year because of COVID, but you've got a group now with Tipperary and Waterford coming up, two Munster teams. How much are you looking forward to those games, and what are you expecting from both of those teams?
Well, to be honest, you can never predict a game between Waterford and Tipperary because it's always diehard until the final whistle is blown. And I feel it's tit for tat for the whole game. And they're two such physical teams as well, you know, that it's a constant slog throughout the game. So I think what will be really important, as you said, is such a condensed season that it's not going to be 15 players, it's going to need to be 20 to 21 players, you know, that are coming on throughout the game, because it is going to be tough, and especially against the likes of Tip and Waterford, when we always have a good battle with them, and there's a nice little bit of rivalry as well between those teams. So it's good to get off to a good start as well. So hopefully we will be able to.
Indeed, it is. And I just think that the prospect of actually just getting to play again would be fantastic, not just for yourselves, but for Camogie players all over the country, and just something to focus on, something new after such a gap. But prior to that gap, there was disappointment in last year's All-Ireland semi-final. How much of that is a motivating factor, or is it a motivating factor for Cork as they start off a new campaign again?
Yeah, there's two sides of it too, I suppose. You know, you don't want to dwell on it too much and use it too much and focus on that disappointment. You want to try and start the year fresh. But then on the other side of things, it's so hard to forget. Even when I was talking to Libby the other day about that match last year, and we were doing a bit of analysis, we were just saying, you know, we were just so frustrated with the game. So I suppose it would nearly annoy us to talk about it too much, but it is definitely a motivating factor, knowing that we could have done better, you know, and just wanting to do better this year. And I think the last 2 years, we haven't been successful. And I think it's just bringing back around now again, and training hard and enjoying training hard and wanting to do better and wanting to improve again and making sure we put our best foot forward, I think. But it's, yeah, well, we will look at it and how we can improve from that. I think we have to take it with a pinch of salt as well and try and focus on a new year now and new management and try and drive forward from that.
Yeah, because I think it says a lot about the high standards that Cork Camogie sets for itself when it's 2018 since you last won in All-Ireland. And it's not a crisis, but it's looked upon as like, you know, we need to be getting this. We need to write this. There's a bit of added pressure. Do you feel any added pressure as being the captain now?
I don't feel any added pressure as being the captain. I think you're still going to work as hard as you can, and you're still going to try and put your best foot forward to make the team, and you're still going to do your best for the team. You know, it is a team game at the end of the day. So, I mean, one player, everyone has to pull together, you know. So I feel it's not so much, I don't feel a sense of pressure. I feel like I'd love for the rest of the girls to learn from me if they can learn anything from me, and to pull them along together, and hopefully we'll all roll the same way.
Indeed. And a lot of that, what you're talking about there, stems from your club, Courcey Rovers. Let's just very briefly, because we had the pleasure in the Southern Star of interviewing quite a lot of your squad and of your management team, and just the sense of pride at winning a first senior county title against a really, really good team in Enniscarra, as you well know, one of the best, scoring 1-5. As you managed as well in the final. I mean, it's comic book stuff. I mean, I asked the players, as I have done in previous interviews, has it sunk in? Obviously, it's sunk in that you're champions at this point, but that must still be very fresh in the memory and an absolutely lovely memory to have.
Oh, it's huge. And I suppose, like you say, has it sunk in? Like every time we say it, it's still such a novelty, you know? And I feel, we were talking the other day and we were saying, you know, the championship is being pushed out so much that we were saying, if the championship doesn't go ahead this year, does that mean that we were going to be champions again for 2021? But obviously we'd love to earn that title again. But no, great, great achievement. We were just delighted. Everyone, as I said, everyone came together on the day, worked so hard. But the thing was, is everyone enjoyed working hard because they could see the person beside them were putting their best foot forward, so then they knew that they had to work hard as well to make the team, you know. And the numbers that were at training, the crack that was had, just everything, and just seeing a smile on people's faces after the county final and everyone having something to talk about, as you said, creating a conversation. You know, when the rugby was on a few weeks ago, everyone was talking about the rugby, you know. I feel around that time everyone was just talking about Camogie, and we just loved it. I feel like it does put a smile on our face every time we say it, and there definitely is a sense of pride. And we're still zooming away anyway on a Tuesday and a Saturday. I don't know how that hasn't worn off yet, but we're loving the catch-ups anyway.
I was going to ask that. I know all about the infamous Zoom sessions and what goes on. Well, I'm told what goes on in them, but I mean, is it kind of a rite of passage for a Courcey Rovers Camogie pair that you have to go through this?
Yeah, well, I don't know. It was this time last year, I'd say, Shirley said, look, I'm training anyway. Would anybody else like to join in? And everyone started to join in. But you see, the thing was, is it wasn't, this is the time the training is on. This is when everyone has to show up. It was a matter of training's on, if you want to show up, you know, you can, or, you know, it was almost a social thing as well, because we'd be having a bit of crack, what book are you reading, or, you know, Shirley, you killed us there on Tuesday night, you know, things like this, and you'd be having a bit of banter there before and afterwards. So it was more of a social thing than anything else. And then people started to get fitter, and people started to realise they were benefiting from it. So then it kind of got a bit addictive then after a while.
How easy was it to kind of skive off in the middle of those sessions with Shirley Maloney's eyes on you?
Not very.
I can see that, actually. Yeah.
Always on the ball.
Yeah. When you become a county champion and now you become an inter-county captain, things change. I mean, you do your best so that they don't change. You know, you're the same person, you're the same player, you're the same talented player. You wouldn't be where you are if you didn't have that talent and that work ethic that you have. But as a captain, you also have to lead now, and you have to talk to your manager, and you have to do things on behalf of the players. So there's quite a bit of, I know you said you haven't changed as a captain, but coming into the year, it's not necessarily an added pressure, but it's something nice on top of everything else, like going back as an inter-county player to look forward to. And you, from listening to you, you're ready for this. I can tell that you're ready for this.
Yeah, and I am looking forward to it. And I think, you know, a lot of the girls would know me and what I'm like. And Hannah Looney is always talking about how positive I am. And she's like, Linda, how are you so positive? But I don't know. I just think it's so important to focus on the positives. And I'd love to get the best out of players this year. And even as a player last year, I would love to have thought that I would have tried my best with people as well. But I think it's so important that people do get to have someone to have the chat with and tell them that they are going well. And I suppose it is another title at the end of the day, but in one sense, everyone has the same goal, you know? And I think that was especially last year with Courcey's, everyone had the same goal to win a county final. This year, we all have the same goal, but I think it's really important to go step by step. And I think the support I'd love to give to the girls, if anyone has any questions or anything like that, I'd love to be there to answer them. You know, I'd love to be able to support the girls the best way that I can, in any way that I can for the year. So,
good answer, natural captain. And just finally, I wanted to mention your family, because your family are very, very much involved in the Courcey Rovers team. Your brother is Liam, and your sister Teresa, I know they're quite involved, but your mammy, Geraldine, talk to me about Geraldine and how involved she is in Courcey Rovers and how proud she must be.
Yeah, so my mom is vice chair of the club at the moment, and she used to be chairperson years ago, but always at every game, would drop me to training. When we played Galway last year, I said, oh, I don't know, my leg could be really sore, because I was a bit injured last year. And I said, my leg could be a bit sore if I have to drive home. She said, oh, I'll drive you up, you know, and it was driving up to Galway, you know. So, I mean, I'm just so appreciative of everything she does do. And then we, like, sometimes if we had a match or anything and I didn't want to drive and she was going along as well, she'd always just, and she'd have everything ready, you know, do you want pasta, do you want this, you know, it's always offering different things. And she knows not to talk about the matches and stuff in the morning, whereas my dad could be asking questions or my brother could be asking questions and I'd be saying no, and my mom would be nearly telling them not to ask the questions. But and we actually, I was walking with my sister yesterday and we met one of the other moms of a player. And I said to my sister, I said, I never knew you were such good friends with her. She said, Linda, many a day we spent on the sideline offering each other, I'm going for a cup of tea now, do you want me to get you one, or is everyone okay, do you want a Maltese, or passing around the sweets and things like this. And she said, Linda, you'll miss the crack on the sideline. So it does make you really proud knowing how much they enjoy being on the sideline and watching the matches and stuff as well. So I suppose you do it for them just as much as you do for yourself.
If I was to bring your dad, your brother and your sister on now and ask them who's the pet, who's mommy's pet, would that be you?
Potentially.
Potentially, I think so. Yeah. Listen, Linda, just finally, Cork are getting ready for, as we said, another crack at the Camogie National League title. It'll be good to hit the ground running. It's not going to be easy. Tip and Waterford, as you said, are really going to put it up to you. But just finally, for the Camogie supporters out there who are dying to watch you again and get behind you again, how excited are you and the team, and what are you most looking forward to about this season?
This season I'm most looking forward to getting back to enjoying Camogie, working hard, training hard, and seeing all the girls and having the crack before and after training, because I think that's when you start to enjoy it. Once you're having the crack with the girls and you're like part of a sort of a community, and I feel when you go so long without seeing them, you're really looking forward to getting back seeing everyone again. So I suppose the crack before and after training and working and training hard is what I'm most looking forward to, and I know the girls are as well, and playing matches and hopefully coming out the right side of them.
Well, the very best of luck from everybody here at the Southern Star to you and the Cork Senior Camogie team and the other Cork Camogie teams this year as well. Hopefully we'll catch up with you down the line.
Lovely. Thanks so much, Ger.
Thanks for listening to the Star Sport Podcast, number one for sport in West Cork.
Welcome back to the Star Sport Podcast. And before we finish up, we're just going to preview what's to come in this Thursday's Southern Star Sports section. So, Kieran, you might give us a teaser of what readers can expect.
Yeah, plenty of reading in this Thursday's Southern Star, Jack. We have interviews with Darren Sweetnam and Lina Collins. You heard from those two in our podcast just a little bit earlier. So we've good stuff with them in this week's Star. Also, the golf courses of West Cork are open again next Monday. So golfers right across the region will be practicing their swings this weekend and dusting down their golf clubs and polishing up their golf shoes as they head out in the course next Monday. So Ger McCarthy caught up with a few different people from a few different golf clubs, from the course superintendent in Kinsale to Sarah Claridge in Skibbereen Golf Club to kind of Kilty Golf Club's captain as well. So good stuff there on the opening of golf clubs. As well as that, I'm looking at the different managerial teams in the various West Cork senior football and hurling teams, because the county championship draws are coming up next week. So just having a look at who will be plotting success for their various senior teams this year. They also caught up with Kirby Rangers and Cork footballer John O'Rourke after the Munster senior football championship draw today. So good interview with John O'Rourke in this Thursday Southern Star. He's chatting about how Cork need to kick on this year, build on their improvement in 2020, rebound from the Munster final loss. And he also gives his thoughts on his Kirby Rangers clubman, John Hayes, who's gone in as a Cork senior football selector. So there's plenty in there, Jack, plenty for our readers to get stuck in this Thursday.
Brilliant stuff. And of course, if you can't make it to the shop to pick up a copy of the Southern Star, you can just go online to www.southernstar.ie/e-paper, and you can read the Southern Star on your computer, tablet or smartphone for less than €2 per week. I just want to give a quick plug to something else I'm doing on the Southern Star website this week, and that is a new review series of the West Cork podcast. So we're going back and listening to every episode of the West Cork podcast and giving a West Cork perspective on each of them. So check that out. That's on www.southernstar.ie/news. Thanks for listening to the Star Sport Podcast. We'll be back at the same time next week. If you enjoy these shows, please make sure to rate, review and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts. And remember, we're nearly at 1,000 subscribers on YouTube specifically. So if you could click on, even if you listen to the podcast on Apple or Spotify, just fire up the YouTube app on your phone, click subscribe to the Southern Star channel, and it would be a great help. Me and Kieran are both in desperate need of gold-plated front teeth, and if we get 1,000 subscribers, we'll be that much closer to doing that.
What we could do, Jack, sorry, Jack, before we finish up, we could ask the fans who are leaving the Big Six to join us in the Star Sport podcast. So instead of United and Liverpool entertaining them every week, come across to us and we'll keep you entertained for the next couple of weeks and months. And we promise we won't join a podcast super league, Jack. We're too down to earth men. We know where our bread is buttered, so we won't be leaving for anywhere higher. So join us on the podcast. Close it in on 1,000 subscribers.
On YouTube, yeah.
Wow.
So, well, yeah, I would just like to distance myself from those comments from Kieran. If any podcast supergroup wants to come and poach me, I'm more than willing to have the conversation. Thanks for listening again. Slán tamall.